Here is the midnight news, and this is Alvar Liddell reading it. Up to 10 o'clock, 175 German aircraft have been...
Thousands of you in this country have had to leave your home and be separated from your fathers and mothers.
I am speaking to you from the cabinet room of 10 Downing Street. This morning, the British ambassador...
Put your books down and get your gas masks out. Quietly. And take them carefully out of their boxes.
Now we're breaking into our programmes for the second time tonight, this time with some splendid news from Moscow.
Berlin. In the small hours of this morning, May the 7th, 1945, I saw the formal acknowledgement by Germany's present leaders of their country's complete and utter defeat.
This is London calling. Here is a news flash. The German radio has just announced...
Mostly there were dairy farms around here, and also up on the hill there was, they said this area was like the part of New Zealand most like England, because from here up to the top of the hill there were small farms, houses, trees and hedges, and now it's all open market garden land, so it's changed completely.
Well, it was a bigger place than what it is now. There were two grocery stores, a garage, a dairy factory, two blacksmiths, hotel, and they had all the facilities.
The main shopping day in Pukekohe was Thursday, and all the farmers came in. The men went down to the sale, sell their animals and so forth. And the women stayed in the town and did their shopping, and they went to the local tea rooms for lunch. It was a big event, coming into the town to do their shopping. And some of the ladies belonged to the clubs, there was only one club, and they would go there. The big bargain store in Pukekohe was McGinty's Bargain Store, and they sold everything. They were the bargains from China, socks, stockings, anything you wanted, McGinty's had it. Kevins were there, Wharfs, Kevins, Wrights, and at the lower end of the town there was the Beehive Stores, I remember. And the top end was Perkins's. They sold clothing. No, not so much clothing, but Manchester, and groceries and hardware.
Bakery.
And they had the seed store at the side. And outside, or still in those, even just before the war, they had a hitching post to tie the old horses up. But generally, just a quiet thing, quiet town. People just came in to do their business and off they'd go home again.
Yeah, it was very quiet. Nothing ever went on in this town. Most of the population went to Auckland for nightlife. There was nothing doing around here. Everybody just seemed to be working.
I am speaking to you from the cabinet room at 10 Downing Street. This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently this country is at war with Germany.
Happened. Well, I happen to remember very well the morning that war broke out in 1939 as a nine-year-old boy in the hills on the sheep station in the back of the Bombay Hills in Paparata. We'd had a radio in our home for just for a few weeks, and the message came through that the Germans had entered Poland. And as a little chap, I had to run for a mile or so to the cow shed where my dad was milking a herd and tell him that the Germans had entered Poland. Bearing in mind, my dad had spent 4 years of his life on the Western Front preventing the Germans from taking the world over, as it were, just 20 years before. He was there from 1917 to 1919. So, I remember he wasn't at all pleased to get that news on that early morning.
I was actually down the back chasing the house cow, bringing it into the shed to milk. And my mother came down, she said, war's broken out. Didn't mean much to me. And my neighbours went all sort of hysterical. Their husbands were going to be called up. And my neighbour said, oh, your son will be going to war shortly, Mrs. Berry. No, he's not going to war, I'm going to hide him up the chimney.
Yeah, when the war broke out, I was in the fifth form at Pukekohe High, and we were actually, the first I heard of it, that the war had actually broken out, we were on our way home from Auckland in the car, and in those days it took us an hour and a half to get from Auckland to Buckland, and we'd stopped at Otahu I'm not sure why we stopped. My stepfather got out. Maybe the adults were interested in the news and what was going on, and I think probably they were. And he came back to the car and he said, "War's been declared. We're at war." And that was when it first really registered with us. I don't think as students at high school we were. I don't remember that we were very much concerned about, well, we knew what was happening in Europe, we knew what Hitler was doing, but I don't think we had thought much about how it was going to affect us, because we didn't have, you know, sort of the instant news, no television, and not that many people had radios at that time. We were just starting to get radios, but back in 1935, few people had radios.
I remember when war broke out, we came over the radio in the morning about 9 o'clock, and I was delivering groceries. I was on the ground delivering groceries to Waiapa.
I was at home, the radio was going and the news came over, and we clustered around the radio. I remember my brother was there, and he had been in the territorials training. And our first thought was at the time was that he would have to go into the army.
As soon as I turned 18, I got a notice in the post to report to Rutland Street. I was in Rutland Street in Auckland then. And of course, they went through all the rigmarole and everything else, and they said, "Oh, you'll hear from us." So it wasn't very long. I did hear from them. I was in the territorials until I was 21 in New Zealand here, training all the time. As soon as I turned 21, about 3 days later, they said, "You're off to Egypt."
There was a big hui there for the farewell. Big kai, and then big farewell, and then They moved to the stations and from there to, overseas. There were a lot of tears and a lot of wailing. Wailing, you know, they're all queers when they, you know, farewell. And they say their farewells in Māori. Haerera, haerera, haerera.
Most of the males around here went to war. They're all called up. You had to be very sick to get a disability not to go to war. There's quite a few of them that didn't go to war, and the ones who did, their parents were really angry because some of them got killed. Why should they be rejected just because they're walking lame?
The boys in our form were leaving high school to go into the army. One boy left from the sixth form to go into the Air Force, and he was killed not very long after that during training. Another boy left to go and train as from the sixth form, went to go, I think then they had to go to Australia to train as officers, and he went off to train as an officer. So we were started that by the time we'd got part of the way through high school, we were really realising what was happening. And so many men were going into the forces, and boys that were, you know, as soon as they were 18, quite a few of them volunteered and went.
Well, for a young fellow attending at that stage Bombay School, with the recreation ground immediately across the road from the Bombay School, the New Zealand troops first came. They had Valentine tanks, and we were able to sit in one of those and have a look at things. They had a headquarters the other side of the Bombay Hill in the hollow called the Dead Cow, and they're also in the bush on the frontage of Bombay Hills, where at night time we could see the searchlights training in Auckland.
Well, it was quite exciting when the army came. There was all sorts of, especially for us kids, we didn't realise really what was going on in the world. They arrived. They had the infantry first, and they used the machine guns. They camped up on the just off the road on the farm there, and they must have been there. Well, they were there 2 or 3 months anyhow. We had the North Island tanks, they come after the infantry, and the North Island tanks, and they were there for quite a while. We used to take the tanks down fishing. It's quite exciting. And then the South Island tanks, they come the second time, and they were there about 6 months too. They used to enjoy up there. Then they had the army, they camped up there for quite a while, and they used to have the airplane, the two-winged tiger moth, come over and look for them, and they'd be all hiding in the lupins, and they reckon they would look like a lot of turkeys waiting to be shot, looking up with all they could see with these faces and the lupins.
I remember the Home Guard too, of course, which my father was in, and they used to learn to shoot with wooden rifles because they had no rifles to spare, and all the money went to the war effort.
The Home Guard turned out with some 1,000 men, quite a number of those, including my dad, and that had been through the First World War period, 20 years previously. Bearing in mind that New Zealand had exported most of its ammunition in 1942, and it was on board the Niagara, a ship which was sunk by a German mine off Whangarei Heads. And the result was that everybody who had a pea rifle or any sort of a gun at all, they were issued with one round of ammunition in the urgent period.
They had a bridge that took on, had blocked across the bridge to stop the Japs. And there was two alongside where they took our sailors. There was another, about that square, the blocks across the bridge.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
And I heard on the radio that the Japs had bombed Pearl Harbor. And I rushed down from the house down to the cow shed and shouting to Mum, "The Japs have bombed Pearl Harbor, the Japs have bombed Pearl Harbor, now the United States will be in the war." And up till that stage, you know, we won the war in the end, but people don't realise how it was up till that stage. For 2 years we'd been losing everything. We'd had Dunkirk and we'd lost in Africa at that stage. And Singapore had fallen, and just about everything had gone, you know, sort of had gone wrong. And all of a sudden there was this ray of hope that finally the Americans were going to be in the war. And we'd been worried until then about the Japanese, because our soldiers were all over in Europe. And we thought the Japanese were coming down through the, you know, through the Pacific.
Yes, I remember when the Americans first came up the Great South Road, past what became Ravensthorpe, and the collision crossroads at Bombay. And I was riding a push bicycle up the hill to catch a school bus from Mangatawhiri into the Pukekohe High School in that days. And that particular morning, there was tremendous flow of traffic, tanks and tank carriers and huge trucks and vehicles, and there'd never been anything anywhere near that the transportation and the movement of vehicles that there was that particular morning on the Great South Road. And pretty scary, because it was a much narrower transport road than what it is now. The next thing was when the Americans arrived by train, and they came into the Pukekohe station, and they were, the main group of them were en route for camping on the race course at Pukekohe. But of course they marched up the main street and down Queen Street to get to the race course from the station.
It was 1942, in the spring of 1942, when I first met an American soldier. We'd heard that the Americans were coming. Up until then, the race course here in Pukekohe had been made into an army camp for New Zealand soldiers, and quite a few of the South Island soldiers had been camped there at the race course in Pukekohe, and a lot of the huts were up and tents were all over the place. But and then we heard that the Americans were coming. But you have to realise that we had a great shortage of petrol. We weren't as mobile. People today, you know, you can be from A to B in a very short time. But when you've only got bikes and hardly any petrol for your car, the distances you can travel are quite limited. We didn't even go into Pukekohe from where I lived, 5 miles out of Pukekohe. Once a week was a major expedition into Pukekohe then, and so though we'd heard the Americans were coming, I hadn't seen anything of them.
The American presence in Pukekohe was an exciting time. The race course, the showgrounds, and the Doctor's Hill area. There was a big encampment there. The headquarters for the American presence was in the Malt House. just on the corner of Roos Avenue. Encampment was in the Ostrich Farm Road area in the Slaffers. The next exciting thing that I visited immediately after the war would be Seagrove Aerodrome, an extension of Clark's Beach.
I remember being out swimming with my older brother and younger sister at this stage, and my mother assumed a stance of fear from the batch and called to us to come in, and she'd never done that before, and she was looking up into the sky, so we all followed her gaze, and there was a plane with markings that weren't, of course, that we had grown to know, the usual New Zealand Air Force insignia, and it was a red, I can remember red, and I, by this stage I was five, I guess. And we all went back because of the fear she had emanated to us. So I think that just showed you how close the enemy were, and just down the road from Clark's Beach, well really just around the corner, was a Seagrove airfield which had been made very quickly during the war, in which people had moved into. There were some Americans there, as well as New Zealanders, and they were training, and they were sending planes out from there. And I guess the Japanese had known about that air force and that air base very quickly. The Land Girls did a wonderful job, and they were always held in high esteem. And I guess as a child, I actually thought one day I may be a Land Girl, you know, thinking it was going to go on forever.
Well, there was hundreds of acres of gardens around Patamaho, from the Pukekohe to Patamahoe Road, and right down through the Malk Road. They had a big station by the Patamahoe Railway Station, which was their headquarters, and they used to go to there every morning and then distribute them around the different gardens.
I know some of the girls were conscripted to the market gardens and dehydration plants. They had to go. If they were told they were going, they were going. But all my sisters, they worked on the farm, and two of them were called up to the gardens for a while. Especially when they had to harvest the cabbages and stuff like that. But they had a lot of fun, the girls. That's what was good.
Well, I worked at the dry cleaners in Pukekohe when I was about 16, 17. And it was essential industry then, and all the Americans used to bring their uniforms in to be cleaned and all that sort of thing. And that time was when we went to the gardens. They wanted...
You were conscripted.
Well, no, I wasn't really, because our dry cleaning was essential, but I wanted to go to the gardens. And it was much better than being at the dry cleaning.
There's a lot of things that I don't remember about the war, but I did go to the gardens. We did our bit.
We went on a
growing
truck.
Growing vegetables, didn't we?
Yes. Yeah. Went on a covered truck to work from Pukekohe at 8 o'clock. We left, did we? 8 o'clock.
It was probably an old army truck, was it?
I think it was a covered army truck.
Sits along the sides.
Mm. And on our way home, I always remember we used to sing all the way home. It was always fun, wasn't it? I don't know that we sang on the way in.
Probably not. but the girl days, that day were good days, actually, surprisingly.
Wonderful days.
Yeah. I remember the first day at the gardens. We went into a carrot patch. The carrots were all ready, and we were digging up the carrots, putting them into bags. And it was so hot, so hot. I didn't take a hat, did I? I mean,
First day, we didn't.
I mean, you're going outside to work, but it just didn't occur to me. Well, I think Bert and I both got sunstroke. We were quite sick that night, but that's the way it was, and sunburned as well, because we were... We weren't warmed, I suppose.
We still got used to it, didn't we?
Still got what?
We got used to it after a while.
Oh, yes. You learned to take a hat, didn't you?
Well, the cabbage, big bags of cabbages, big sacks, they were thrown up on, a truck came round, and I don't think we threw them up, I think a man was around to load the trucks up, and they were taken probably to the dehydration, I think, wasn't it?
Did some of the food that we grew, that went to the Pacific Islands?
They did, that's true.
I think there was war in the Pacific at that time.
At the beginning, I think that was right, yes.
I'm sure we were going, it was to go to the Pacific.
To the Pacific.
And there were,
and the carrots. And we had to be careful not to have the carrots with their little, they had to be perfect carrots, not deformed ones.
Deformed.
Yes.
I will never forget. I've never had any feeling in my hands since, I don't think. They were so cold because the big bags of cabbages used to come into the cooler and then they'd bring them into us. We would be sitting on a belt, on a chair, with the cabbages going past. We had to tear off the old rubbish and put them behind us on a table.
That's right.
And then there was people behind us
packing
them into boxes. So, and that really went on, the actual peeling cabbages was... Oh,
forever.
Did I ever get sick of peeling cabbages? And they were so cold. And our bosses, we're not talking about that.
The girls of the district, they arranged dances for both the New Zealanders and the Americans. Some old girls with a startled look when they start their GI jiving and flaming, what do they throwing the girls around about. And they had a lot of fun.
Our local dances were, we had a piano and drums and the saxophone, and that was our music that we danced to. And but the Americans had the big bands with maybe up to 30 people in the band, and so it was great excitement for us to be able to even listen to such things. So they sent their trucks out around the area, and sometimes we were in evening dress, long dresses, and sometimes we were in just ordinary clothes, but we had to climb up into the back of these high army trucks, and we were sort of hauled up into the backs of them, and there was always a chaperone to keep an eye on us, and there was we'd be in very serious trouble if we disappeared from the dance hall at any stage of the night. And we were taken home in the truck,
and they had these great big boots on because they didn't have shoes, and we used to come home with our feet blue being walked on.
When it came through, there was a great sense of excitement, and everybody was getting together to sort of celebrate. And in Pukekohe, I remember most people would go, the idea was to go down to the hotel. We didn't actually go in the hotel, but the street was crowded. Everybody just melt, and they're singing and going on. Everybody was happy and talking to everybody, and the war had finished. That was the main topic. The war had finished. Everybody was very excited.
Well, there was great delight actually when the war was over. All the troops were able to come home again. My brother was away in the war, and my brother-in-law, I had two brother-in-laws away in the war. And when they came home, there was a great reunion.
It was a team effort by all of New Zealand to keep our country wholesome, to keep our country ours.
I think what it is, through the wars and the Anzac occasion, I feel that it needs to be maintained, not to, and for the younger generation to what the old soldiers have been through, and might be a lesson to the younger generation, and to see if anything crops up again, what's the advert going to be?
If you had an enemy like we had, that was that we had no choice. It was either fight or, you know, sort of be invaded and lose everything, democracy and all the rights and the privileges that we had in a democracy. That if you really had to fight for it, I think you probably, looking at them, I think this generation probably would, if they were in the same situation, no matter how you know, sort of they look back and think what a terrible thing it was. And so hopefully they will never be in the same situation where they've actually got to fight for the things that are precious to them. But the one thing that I do think, I think they should take more interest in what's going on around them. I think they should take more interest in their politics of their country, what their governments are doing, and not, it's just apathy that can lead to losing all these rights and privileges that we have in the country. And so I think that's the most important thing I can say to them, that, you know, the price of liberty is eternal vigilance.
Oh, well, it's peace now. Because during the war, well, it's just tension, and, you know, parents worrying about what's going to happen, if our kids going to be dragged in at that time, right through the war years. And there were a lot of you know, people ready to go to war then. And, it was total fear comparing to now. It's paradise now.
Picture frame.